Towers of Midnight begins with Landman Dragorin. Lan is riding through Saldea on his way to Tarwyn's Gap. He comes across Beulen, who's someone he met during the Aeol War. Beulen is half Malkeri, and he informs Lan of Nynaeve's message to all the Malkeri. Beulen wants to join Lan, but Lan is sure that he's riding to his death, so he wants to go alone. He then remembers the promise he made to his wife Nynaeve, so he lets Beulen join him on his journey, and now the One becomes two. As they ride through the Kandori and Saldean border, they come across three other men. Two of them wear the Hadori, and the other one doesn't. Lan tells them not to follow him, but they don't listen. After some arguing, Lan allows them to join him, and so the two become five. As they keep on riding through the borderlands, they keep on finding more and more men on the way. When they arrive at the Arafel border, the five had become dozens. Lan Mandragoran and his followers arrive at the border of Kandor and Arafel, and they find thousands of people waiting for him, many of which wear the Hadori. He's informed that his wife Nynaeve told him that he'll be coming. Lan finally gives in and announces that the Golden Crane rides for Tarmogaidon. Grendel and Arengar are at Netrin's Barrow in Nar-a-Doman. When they intercept Lord Ramshalan, Grendel realizes that Rand is the one that sent him, so he knows of her hideout. She tells Arengar and Delanna Musalain, a member of the Black Aja, to place compulsion on Ramshalan so they can trick Rand. They then send Ramshalan back to Rand. Grendel uses a bird to follow and spy on Ramshalan. Grendel sees that Rand has the access key, and she realizes that she has been played. Rand only sent Ramshalan to Netrin's Barrow to make sure she was present, and now that he knows that she is there, he will use the access key to destroy her. Grendel thinks fast and decides to let both Arengar and Delanna die because they had made the Weave of Compulsion on Ramshalan, so in order for Rand to think that she is truly dead, that compulsion needs to disappear. Grendel shields Arengar and Delanna both to make sure that they don't escape, and then she escapes through a gateway. Afterwards, Morden finds her, and he chastises her for letting Arengar die. Grendel tells him that she did it because she knows that Rand will suffer knowing that he killed many innocents when he destroyed Netrin's Barrow. Morden receives a message from the Dark One, telling him to let Grendel go without punishment. Grendel then reveals her plan to kill Perrin Ivara. Morden decides to help her with this plan, so he takes her to a room filled with objects of power, and he gives her a dream spike, which is a Tarangrial that makes a dome-like barrier that prevents instant transportation in or out of it in both Talaranriad and the real world. He also lends her the assistance of Slayer and shows her a book filled with the Shadow's prophecies. They interpret one of these prophecies as Perrin dying at their hand. Padan Fain is on the Blight when he comes across some Trollocs and a Murdral. He attacks them with Mashadar and gains control over the Trollocs, but not the Murdral. He keeps referring to himself as Padan Fain and Mordeeth, and thinks that he will need a new name soon. Fain prepares to kill Randall Thor once and for all. The new Lord Captain Commander of the Children of the Light, Galad Damodred, and his children are riding through a swamp in Gildan. Galad knows that the last battle is upon them, so he has decided to fight next to the Aes Sedai in order to defeat the Shadow. As he exits the swamp, Galad is surrounded by High Inquisitor Radam Asunawa and five Lord Captains. Asunawa declares Galad a Dark Friend and says that he only defeated Aemon Balda because of his connection to the Shadow. Asunawa is ready to fight Galad and his loyal forces, but Galad doesn't want White Cloak to fight White Cloak. So in exchange for the safety of his men, he surrenders. Asunawa and his questionnaires take Galad and they torture him. After some time, Galad awaits his death, but he's saved by Dane Bornhold, Jared Byer, and three Lord Captains. They show him Radam Asunawa's head, and the three Lord Captains apologize for following Asunawa. They are all now willing to accept Galad as their captain commander. Galad accepts their allegiance and he tells them that they must march for Andor. On their way to Andor, the Children of the Light capture a caravan that's being led by Basil Gil. Basil and his companions are questioned separately and they reveal that they are traveling with Perrin Ivara. Galad doesn't know who Perrin is, but Dane Bornhold and Jared Byer do. Bornhold tells Galad that Perrin Goldeneyes is responsible for his father's death. Bornhold and Byer tell Galad about their encounters with Perrin at both Falma and the Two Rivers. Galad decides to bring Perrin to justice. Perrin Ivara keeps having dreams of forging something important, but he doesn't know what. Hopper is always with him in his dreams and he keeps teaching Perrin how to master the wolf dream, but Perrin cannot fully embrace his wolf aspect because he is too afraid of losing his humanity. Perrin and his army are still marching through Gildan and they have no access to gateways because his Ashaman are still recovering from a sickness and they cannot maintain one at the moment. They get the idea of forming a circle with the Aes Sedai and they manage to create some small gateways, so they send people away to gather information. A Maiden of the Spear named Sulin arrives to inform Perrin that a large army of Children of the Light have been spotted right in front of them. He then learns that the children have captured Basil Gil. Dane Bornhold then arrives to speak with Perrin and he tells him that the Lord Captain Commander wants to speak with him. Perrin agrees to go, and when he meets Galad for the first time, he notices that he doesn't smell sickly like the rest of his white cloaks. Perrin demands that he lets Basil Gil and the other prisoners go, and Galad agrees, but only after they meet on the field of battle. Galad doesn't want to negotiate, so Perrin simply walks away. Perrin knows that he can easily defeat the White Cloaks with his channelers, but he doesn't want it to come to that. Still, after discussing it further with his camp, they decide to go to battle with the White Cloaks. At night, Perrin returns to the Wolf Dream to train with Hopper, and they come across Slayer once again. Perrin, who just recently learned to shift in the dream, uses this skill to sneak attack Slayer, but Slayer has much more skill in the dream, so he fails. Perrin eventually retreats, and Hopper angrily tells him that he's not ready to face Slayer. The next day, Perrin and his army go to battle with the White Cloaks, and the Ashaman tell him that gateways are not working for some reason. Perrin really wants to avoid conflict with the children, so he asks his Ashaman to fire some warning shots, and then he asks to speak with Galad one more time. Galad didn't think the One Power would be used because he knows that the Aes Sedai cannot engage in battle due to the Three Oaths, but he had no idea that the men in the black coats could channel, so he agrees to speak with Perrin. When Galad arrives to speak with Perrin, he's taken aback by Berlane. He thinks that she's absolutely beautiful. During that discussion, Perrin admits to have killed two White Cloaks all the way back in Book 1, but he says that he did it out of self-defense since the White Cloaks killed his wolf friend, Hopper. Bornhold then accuses Perrin of killing his father, but Perrin tells him that he died battling the Sonchan back in Book 2. Perrin agrees to stand trial for these accusations, but they can't agree on who would be the judge. One of Perrin's servants catches Galad's eye, and he realizes that she's his stepmother, Queen Morghese Trakand. The two hug each other, and she tells Galad that Perrin has been keeping her safe. Perrin and Galad ask her to be the judge, and she agrees. At night, Perrin goes back into the wolf dream, and Hopper tells him that there's a mysterious dome. They try to shift into the dome, but for some reason they can't. Perrin suspects that that's the purpose of the dome. Perrin forces his way in, and he faces Slayer once again. But once again, he realizes that Slayer is too strong for him, so he retreats. Perrin knows that he needs to defeat Slayer, but he's still too weak, so he and Hopper continue to train every night. After further investigation, Perrin comes to the conclusion that the dome in the Wolf Dream is what is causing the disturbance with the gateways in the real world. But before he deals with it, he goes to his trial. At the trial, the only crime that Perrin is found guilty of is killing the two White Cloaks back in Book 1. Perrin asks Galad to punish him after the last battle, and Galad agrees. During the trial, Perrin tells Dane Bornhold that his father died a hero fighting the Sonchan next to the Heroes of the Horn, and Bornhold begins to believe him, but Byer doesn't. Byer still believes that Perrin is a Dark Friend. Perrin then goes to deal with the dome. He goes into the Wolf Dream, and Hopper tells him that Slayer is always inside the dome. Perrin concludes that he must be guarding something. He and Hopper and a wolf pack all attack Slayer at once. The wolves manage to find the device making the dome, and it turns out to be a dream spike. Perrin takes the dream spike and he tries to take it someplace where Slayer will not find it, but Slayer keeps chasing him. When Perrin sees the White Tower at a distance, he thinks that he might be able to lose him there. When he shifts to the White Tower, he finds Egwene there, fighting other Aes Sedai. Egwene thinks that Perrin somehow lost in the dream world, and suddenly he's attacked by a Black Aja sister. She shoots Balefire at him, but thanks to Hopper's training, Perrin simply imagines that it is not real, and the Balefire goes right through him. Egwene is amazed, and he tells her that it is just a weave. He then goes back to fight Slayer. Perrin and Slayer fight for some time, and during the battle, Slayer severely wounds Hopper. Perrin manages to stab Slayer in the chest, and then he finds a way to destroy the dream spike, and so the dome disappears. Hopper does not make it, and with his dying breath, he tells Perrin to flee and to seek a wolf named Boundless. Back in the real world, Perrin is devastated by the loss of Hopper. He wants to avenge his death, but he knows that he's not ready to face Slayer. Fael tells him that the gateways are now working, and Perrin figures out that there's an army of Shadowspawn after him, and they're going to attack the White Cloaks, so Perrin sets up a plan to ambush the Shadowspawn and save the White Cloaks. Suddenly, Perrin feels the need to create, so he goes to the forge and he begins forging something. He asks the Ashaman and the Aes Sedai to join him in this creation, and with the power of Saidin and Saidar, Perrin creates a Power Wrath hammer that he names Mahalanir. This is the first Power Wrath weapon created since the breaking of the world. Perrin and his army appear around the White Cloak camp, which makes the White Cloaks think that Perrin is going to attack them, but then the Shadowspawn army appears. The White Cloaks team up with Perrin's army, and together they're victorious. Suddenly, Jared Byer tries to assassinate Perrin for being a Dark Friend, but he's killed by Dane Bornhold. Galad decides to sentence Perrin right away, rather than do it after the last battle. The sentence is that Perrin must pay 500 crowns to the victim's family, and that he fights with all his strength at the last battle. Perrin gladly agrees. They all decide to go to Camelin, and on their way there, Perrin comes across Matrim Cawthon. Perrin and Matt hug, and Matt tells him to meet him at a tavern in Camelin, and then he leaves. Matrim Cawthon and his group are in Camelin. After accepting Beren's deal in the past book, Matt has decided not to open Beren's letter, so he has to remain in Camelin for 30 days. He has sent a letter to Elaine requesting a meeting, but so far he hasn't received an answer. When he hears that a man was mysteriously killed in a very gruesome way, Matt immediately thinks that the golem is responsible. As Matt returns to his room, Teslin Sedai stops him and tells him that she and the other Aes Sedai are returning to the White Tower. She thanks him for rescuing her and her sisters from the Songchan, and Matt, who still doesn't trust Aes Sedai, is shocked by her sincerity. As Matt enters his room, he smells blood and he's suddenly attacked by the golem. Matt manages to get his foxhead medallion and he hurts the golem with it. Then Teslin and Matt's men arrive to help him, but the golem escapes once again. Matt then goes to speak with Tom and Noah Charon, and they agree to hunt down and kill the golem before they depart for the Tower of Genji. Matt still hasn't received a response from Elaine, so he writes her a new letter. At the royal palace, Elaine is dealing with the outcome of the succession war. She wants the nation of Kyrian to join her kingdom, but she doesn't want it to look like Rand is just handing her the Kyrian throne, so she's looking for a way to do it by herself. She finally receives the letter that Matt wrote to her, and she's ecstatic to learn that he and Tom are safe, so she immediately sets up a meeting with them. Matt and Tom arrive to see her, and both she and Brigitta can't believe they escaped Ebudar. Matt tells the story of how they escaped the Songchan, and then he tells her that he and Aludra need her help in producing dragons. At first, Elaine doesn't understand how these dragons could be useful, but then Brigitta explains how useful they could be. Elaine is very impressed, and she wants to keep some of the dragons for Andor, so she and Matt make a deal. The deal is that 1. The Vand of the Red Hand works for Elaine for at least 1 year. 2. Matt will get to keep 1 out of 4 dragons. 3. Elaine gets to keep Matt's medallion for 3 days. And 4. Matt gets a servant. Matt then remembers that according to Olver, Brigitta has been to the Tower of Genji, so he invites her out to drink and he asks her about it. Brigitta doesn't want to talk about it and tells him to stay away from it, but she eventually tells him that she went into the tower because she was trying to save Guido Kane's life, but neither of them were able to escape the tower. She then reveals a bunch of information on what to expect once he's inside, and she gives him some tips. Back at the palace, Elaine is studying Matt's medallion, and she manages to make some copies of it, but the copies are inferior to the original. After she's done, she returns the original foxhead medallion to Matt, who eagerly takes it back. Matt and his men have had enough of the golem, so with the help of Elaine and the kin, they come up with a plan to finally get rid of it. They put their plan into action, and when they get the golem's attention, they lead it into a burning building where the kin await with a gateway. Matt pushes the golem into the gateway, which contains an endless void. The golem will forever be falling into nothing. In the royal palace, Elaine receives a very special visit. Her half-brother Galad and her mother Morghese. The two tell Elaine where they've been and they tell her that Perrin saved them. Elaine then meets with Perrin and Fael, and they discuss what to do about Manetherin and the Two Rivers. After a long discussion, they come to an agreement, which will probably see Perrin's kids and Elaine's kids marry each other. Also, Perrin becomes the High Lord of the Two Rivers. Elaine then meets with the Kyrian nobles. She needs their support in order to gain the Kyrian throne, so to accomplish this, she bribes them. She offers them Andorran land in exchange for their support, and they accept, thus securing the Kyrian throne for Elaine. Perrin goes to see Matt and Tom, and Matt reveals to Perrin that Moraine is alive in the Tower of Genji. Matt asks Perrin for a gateway so they can go save her, and one of Perrin's Ashaman takes them close to the tower, and so Matt, Noah Charon, and Tom Marilyn go off to save Moraine, and Perrin and his army go to the field of Merilor to reunite with Rand. Matt, Tom, and Noel use all of the information they've gathered to enter the Tower of Genji. Once inside, the Elfin and Ilfin try to constantly trick them, but Matt, who already has experience dealing with them, doesn't fall for their tricks. Matt uses his dice and his luck to traverse the maze that's the Tower of Genjai, and eventually they reach the main chamber where they find an unconscious Moraine. In order to leave with Moraine, Matt makes a deal with the Fen. He agrees to give up half the light of the world. The Fen accept and they take one of his eyes. As they're leaving the tower, they're attacked by the Ilfen. Noah Charon tells them to run and he stays behind to fight them off. Matt, Tom and Moraine escape the Tower of Genjai, but Noah Charon does not. Noah Charon turns out to be the famous traveler Jane Farstrider. After Moraine recovers, she asks Tom to marry her, and Tom says yes. He also agrees to become her warder. Matt is very confused by this romance. After Randall Thor's epiphany at the end of the Gathering Storm, Rand now knows that both he and Lewis Theron are one and the same. Rand sees things much clearer now, and he knows what to do next. As he's returning from Dragonmount, he comes across Almen Bunt, who is a farmer. Almen sees all of his crops rotting away due to the Dark One's touch in the world. But as soon as he feels Randall Thor's presence, his apple trees begin to blossom again. When Almen sees Rand, he remembers that he once gave him and Matt a ride to Camelin in Book 1, and he realizes that he is the Dragon Reborn. Rand goes straight to the White Tower, finally ready to meet the new Amerlin, Egwene Alvear. Rand arrives very suddenly, and the Aes Sedai are very nervous and scared because Rand shows absolutely no fear. Rand meets with Egwene and he tells her that the Dark One almost had him, that he was broken, but now he has been reforged. He has only come to tell her that in 1 month's time he will travel to Shai Ghul to break the last remaining seals on the Dark One's prison. He says that the boar must be opened fully before it can be fully sealed. Egwene is very much against his plan, so Rand tells her that the day before he leaves for Shai Ghul, they can meet again at the Field of Marilor and discuss his terms. As he leaves, Egwene notices that he is missing his left hand. Later, Gawain goes to see Egwene. Gawain has been investigating the murderers of 4 Aes Sedai sisters. He tells Egwene that the murderers have been done with a knife and not with the One Power, and that the only thing that the 4 dead Aes Sedai had in common was that they didn't have a warder. So Gawain proposes telling all the Aes Sedai that don't have a warder to get one. Egwene takes this into consideration. She then tells Gawain that she thinks the culprit is Messana, one of the Forsaken. In the last book, Beren told Egwene that Messana was operating within the White Tower, but so far, Egwene hasn't been able to find her. During night patrol, Gawain hears footsteps close to Egwene's room, and when he goes to investigate, he's attacked by someone in the darkness. The two fight, and eventually the attacker gets away. Gawain goes to check on Egwene, and as soon as he steps into her room, he triggers a bunch of traps that she had placed for intruders. Egwene is very angry at him for ruining her traps. Gawain finds one of the assassin's knives and he keeps it. Gawain, who's now angry with Egwene, decides to take a break from her, so he takes a gateway to Camelin to visit his sister Elaine. During this visit, Gawain comes across a former Suldam that recognizes the assassin's knife. She says that it belongs to a blood knife. Blood knives are the Sunchan Empire's most elite assassins, and they each carry a Terangreal ring that gives them strength, speed, and allows them to blend in with the shadows, but it is at the cost of the user's lives. Gawain sends this information to Egwene, but he decides not to return to the White Tower yet because he's still angry at Egwene. In the Stone of Tyr, Nynaeve, Catswain, and Min await Rand's return. He's been gone for 3 days and everyone is worried because of how he left, but Min can feel through the bond that he's much better now. Finally, Min announces that he has returned and everyone goes out to meet him. Rand sees Min, and for the first time in a long time, Rand smiles at her. he announces that Egwene Alvir has succeeded Elaida as the Amorlin seat, and then he tasks Menu with finding out how he can use Kalandor to help him seal the Dark One's prison. Finally, he orders all the High Lords and Ladies to line up, and he calls out two of them for being Dark Friends. He lets both of them go free, but they are to deliver a message to other Dark Friends. The message is that they can no longer hide among his allies, for he is no longer blind. Eventually, Nynaeve tells Rand that she's going back to the White Tower so she can officially become an Aes Sedai. But before she leaves, she also tells him that she knows how to cure the leftover madness on the Ashaman. She tries to cure Rand's madness, but it is too much, so she's unable to. Still, Rand is very impressed by her new skill. He asks Nynaeve to go with him to Shaol Gul when the time eventually comes, because in order to safely use Kalandor, he will need to hold a circle with two Aes Sedai, and he wants Nynaeve to be one of them. The other, he thinks, will be either Elaine or Avienda. When Nynaeve arrives in the White Tower, she immediately takes the test to officially become an Aes Sedai, and she manages to pass, but barely. She then goes to see Mirel, who currently has Lan Mandragoran's bond, and Nynaeve demands that she passes the bond to her. Mirel does, and so Lan finally becomes bonded to his wife, Nynaeve. Egwene Alvir and the Aes Sedai are in Tel Aranriad having a meeting with the Wise Ones and the Sea Folk. Egwene wants the Aiel and the Sea Folk to begin working with the White Tower, but there's still some untrust between the groups. After a long discussion, they'll manage to reach an agreement, so the three groups begin to work together. They suddenly come under attack by the Black Aja, and so a battle in Tel Aranriad ensues. A dome appears over them, and they realize that it is preventing them from leaving. Suddenly, Egwene comes across Perrin, and she thinks that he's somehow lost in the dream world. A Black Aja sister shoots Balefire at him, but Perrin simply imagines the weave disappearing, and the Balefire goes through him. Egwene is amazed by Perrin's ability, and she realizes that Perrin has a lot more experience in the dream world. Perrin tells her that it is just the weave, and then he walks away. Egwene goes back to the battle, and after some time, Messana finally appears. The two face each other, and Messana manages to put an Adam on Egwene, but Egwene uses Perrin's trick and simply believes that it is not real, and it falls off. After this, the two have a battle of wills, and Egwene wins. She breaks Messana's mind. Back in the real world, Gawain goes to say goodbye to Elaine, but Brigitta tells him that she's asleep and probably in Tel Aranriad. Gawain realizes that if Elaine is in Tel Aranriad, Egwene is probably there too, which will make her a perfect target for the Blood Knives in the real world. He takes a gateway back to the White Tower, and on his way there, he takes some of the younglings with him. They immediately go to Egwene's chambers, and they find her asleep. They're suddenly attacked by the Blood Knives, and the two younglings are immediately killed. Gawain remembers that the assassins blend in with the shadows, so he gets rid of the light. The fight becomes a bit easier, and after a long battle, Gawain defeats the Blood Knives one by one, and then he passes out. When Egwene finally wakes up from Tel Aranriad, she finds Gawain almost dead. She realizes that the only way to save him is to bond him as her warder. When Gawain recovers, he goes to see the bodies of the Blood Knives, and he takes their Terangreal rings. After making a deal with the Dragon Reborn, the great captain, Rodo Iturralde, has been doing as he promised and is leading the defense of Saldea's capital against the overwhelming force of the Trolloc army. After withstanding for so long, the great captain's army is now completely broken, and just when it seems that all hope is lost, Randall Thor arrives to help him. Rand is told that the city is lost, but he has other plans. Randall Thor goes to face the massive Trolloc army, and he shows what the Dragon Reborn is capable of. He channels weaves of ice and fire, thunder, earth and wind, he creates death gates and tornadoes, and just like that, the Dragon Reborn decimates an entire army and saves the city. Afterwards, Rand goes to Far Madding to meet with the Borderlanders that have been looking for him. When he meets with the Borderlander rulers, they ask him, how did Talindol Terrasso die? When Rand answers this question correctly, the Borderlanders relax and they say that they had to ask that question because a secret prophecy of theirs required him to answer that question before they accepted him as the Dragon Reborn. Having earned their support, he tells them that tomorrow he will break the seals to the Dark One's prison and to meet him at the Field of Merilor to discuss. We then go over to Avienda, who's on her way to Rudion. In order to become a Wise One, she needs to go through the glass columns. During the night, a mysterious Aiel woman named Nakomi arrives and asks to join her. Avienda says yes, and the two have a long conversation. Nakomi asks Avienda what will happen to their people after the last battle, since their whole purpose was to find the Karakarn and fight at the last battle. Avienda is taken aback and has no answer. Nakomi goes to relieve herself, and when she fails to return, Avienda goes looking for her, but she never finds her. She reaches Rudion and goes through the glass columns, but the revelations that she's shown don't have an impact on her because she already knew them. She returns to the glass columns and uses her ability to read Terangreal on them. After this, she is shown a future of the Aiel. She sees a future through the eyes of her kids and her future generations. After the last battle, there will be a period of peace, but eventually the Aiel will go to war against the Sonchan. The war will be tough, and the Aiel will end up losing. Her people will be broken, and they will become beggars and thieves. Afterwards, she makes her way back to the Wise Ones, determined to prevent this future from ever happening. We then meet Andral Genhold, who is an Ashaman in the Dark Tower. He's very weak in the One Power, but is very talented with gateways, and for this reason, Logain promoted him to dedicated. There's a division in the Dark Tower. There are men that follow the Mahel, Mashram Taim, and the ones that follow Logain. Andral is the leader of a group that follows Logain, and they're currently very worried because Logain has not been seen for some time. Andral and his group notice that the Mahel's men receive special lessons from him, and they learn the One Power much quicker. They also notice that whenever one of Loghain's followers gets one of the Mahel's special lessons, they become loyal to him instead of Logain, and they somehow become completely different people. The group begins to make a plan to find Logain, and they go to seek allies. Andral finds an ally in Pevara. Pevara is one of the Aes Sedai that came to the Black Tower looking to bond Ashaman. She has also noticed that there is something very wrong in the Black Tower, and some of her Aes Sedai sisters have begun acting completely different. Both of them want to leave the Black Tower, but Taim is not letting anyone leave, and gateways no longer work in the area. Andral and Pevara begin to make a plan of escape. Alvar, Talmanis, and the Vand of the Red Hand are in Camelin waiting for Matt to return. Alvar finds the letter that Varen gave to Matt and opens it. When he reads it, he immediately gives it to Talmanis, who's in shock while reading it. It says that if Varen hasn't returned by now, she's dead, and that there's a waygate in Camelin that is not secured. An enormous force of Shadowspawn will go through the waygate and attack Camelin. When Talmanis steps outside, he finds Camelin burning. Finally, we end with Lan. Lan Mandragoran has gathered an army of 12,000 men from all over the Borderlands. When they finally arrive at Tarwyn's Gap, they find a massive army of Trollocs that's 10 times the size of his army. Lan, knowing that he's dying, proclaims himself King of Malkyr and charges into battle. He knows that this is the last charge of the Golden Crane, the fall of the Malkyrie.